is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you by Burger King, the Cleveland Clinic, the Free National Movement, Grand Bahama News, Prince Masters, RF Bank and Trust, and Royal Star Assurance.
Welcome, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well today. If at some point during the show you want to give us a call, remember the numbers are 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can call us from the Family Islands on 242-300-5720. That's 242-300-5720. Or you can text us today on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show, or you can catch us on BTC Flow Channel 612. That's BTC Flow Channel 612. You know, whenever we have the central bank on the show, you know, big things are going, as they like to say. Big things are happening. And today, we have a guest from the bank to talk to us about some exciting things the bank is doing on the digital. I see Mr. Khalil Braithwaite with us today. How are you doing, sir?
I am great, Mr. Laing. How are you doing, sir? All is well?
I am good. I'm good. They send you here solo today?
Yes, they did. Yes, they did. So I hope the message is good enough by the messenger.
I have no doubt that Governor Lewis would only have sent you because they know that you are quite capable. We have been living in a world where things digital have been like the buzz for a little bit now, you know, and we don't even know yet where this is all going to take us. We know that our central bank is the first central bank to issue a central bank backed a digital currency. So what's going on now? Central bank has a campaign going on this front. What's going on?
Yeah, no. So yes, first of all, another gold medal for the Bahamas in many ways. I know we get a lot of attention in the track and field area where we do really well and get gold medals. But in terms of innovation, the central bank deserves a gold medal with being the first CBDC or central bank digital currency. And when you introduce any new innovation, there's always going to be a learning curve before there's an adoption phase. And what the central bank wanted to do was get all of the players in the market, all of those who represent different touch points of everyday lives, and elevate the conversation, elevate the education. And what we're seeing now is a re-energized campaign to bring about the education of CBDCs and the impact it could make.
Okay, and I mean, why is this important? Because, you know, for the bank to have made the move that it made in issuing this digital currency, it obviously wanted to make an impact. So why do we need to get all these folks together to try and shorten this learning curve or speed up this learning curve? Or, you know, so why? What are we trying to accomplish?
Sure. So where I want to tip my hat to the governor and the central bank is we all agree that the world is evolving and expanding at a rapid pace, right? And we know this, that when we know that when Bahamians travel outside of the country, there are solutions that we are familiar with, whether it's Apple Pay or Zelle or all of that. So where I want to give credit to the central bank is, if we look at the conversation of digital, right, and digitization, we look at today's conversation, we look at what the conversation is going to be tomorrow, and then we look at what the conversation is going to be the day after, we now get a better sense or appreciation that we're working on not only tomorrow's solution, but the day after. So we're just working aggressively today to bring that to the Bahamas. And now what is that solution? Pretty much the ability to connect and transact in the absence of traditional payment rails. So where there may be traditional payment rails may not be present, the ability to have a digital dollar held in a digital wallet could allow two people or a commerce to kind of interact. And the forward-thinking nature of this is that if we put the goals for not tomorrow, but the goals that we're aiming for the day after, our tomorrow will be naturally a bigger and better option. And so to crystallize that, the central bank is wanting to provide, with the inclusion of AFIs, the ability for people to digitally hold money, not replace cash, but to complement cash, not to replace any existing systems, but to complement the systems, because we do have an inconsistent infrastructure across the Bahamas. And this could be the one unifying element that brings some level of consistency across the infrastructures. So I hope that made sense.
Perfect sense. And I'm happy you mentioned a couple of things, because I'll give you an example of just what you were talking about when a traditional payment methods is not available. So I'm in Florida, right? And I am halfway from where I'm trying to go get, and halfway from where I came, but I'm out of gas in my SD. Right? And I left my wallet where I came from. So I'm at the gas station. What am I supposed to do? If I had digital currency on my phone, I'd be straight, right? But no, I didn't. So I had to call somebody who had to call somebody who had to call somebody to rescue me.
and to build upon your story, right? We'll take that perfect example. So you had an everyday experience. You were on autopilot. You went somewhere and you forgot your wallet. However, we all know that that phone is a mini computer. So you were able to conduct business, send emails, call people, do a number of things. The one thing we want to add to that is the ability to stay connected to your finances and actually transact. And we've seen that exact scenario play out time and time again. And it usually involves the food store run. So, a colleague of mine went to the food store, and their wife forgot their wallet, and they just canoed them the cash. Because at the end of the day, it's this ability to stay connected with the devices that we actually use. So if you can send an email, you should be able to have some option to pay for gas at minimum.
And the thing about it is, these are options are available in some form. But as you said, you know, it's making that leap now, because you know, Zhivargo, you got to go through this, and you got to go download an app. And so I'm thinking in my head, this is a little complicated, and I have no time for that until you get stuck.
Yeah, no, 100%. But again, you know, change the environment, change the scenario, and people adapt. So I've heard the same conversation many times, but how many Bahamians you know say, oh, I don't know how to download the app, but you travel with them, and they order an Uber from their phone. They get Uber Eats. They do the check-in.
They call in on WhatsApp.
So the reality is, we imagine that the gap is a lot bigger than it is. But what we're trying to do is bring onshore the same capabilities and same features that Bahamians desire offshore. And so we like to look at it and say, oh, this is a hurdle to download a thing, but I like context and comparison. downloading an app versus opening a bank account? Which one may be slower or faster?
give me the app.
Right? And if you're looking at a wallet, right? Because when you have your wallet, like you said, you traveled in Florida. But if you opened up your wallet, you're going to find a Bahamian credit card, some Bahamian cards, maybe some American cards, definitely some Bahamian cash, definitely some American cash. And what happens is that, well, the wallet serves the function of storage. And all we do now is we add storage of a digital currency, but we add another layer of the ability to send, push money back and forth to people or to businesses. And then again, the other layer is that there's commerce that can kind of kick off. And that's a whole separate conversation. But what we've been trying to do as a collective body is acclimate people to saying, hey, this concept is not necessarily new. It's just new because you didn't expect to see it in the Bahamas. And it's extremely new because we didn't go for the standard. We went to go with not today's solution, not even tomorrow's solution, the day after. Because if we get there, it then all of a sudden has a ripple effect. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, thank you. And when you guys, because we're gonna have several conversations this week, and so we want to talk about that commercial end, and we want to talk about all the other practical opportunities that getting to using this digital form of payment provides. But you mentioned something also that I thought was useful to point out, where you indicate, listen, man. So you hear people who talk about digital currencies, right? Like Bitcoin and those, and oftentimes this is a conversation, you correct me if I'm wrong, because these currencies are going to replace fiat currencies, and that's why you need to get into digital currency. That's why you need to get into Bitcoin. That's not the central bank's discussion at all. There, you're saying, no, there is the fiat currency, which is likely to be around for a fairly long time still, but there is this new opportunity to pay alongside the fiat currency, right?
Correct. And I love how you frame that, because there's so much conversation going around digital assets and cryptocurrency. People are naturally grouping the term digital currency, right? Because there's a digital asset, cryptocurrency. So they all hear digital currency. They snap their fingers and say, oh, I know what that means. But the reality is, the reality is that cryptocurrency are commodities where the price can actually fluctuate. So it's more of a commodity. Whereas the central bank digital currency is a central bank digital minting of the dollar. So right. I know your background, and I know you'll have great appreciation. Most people hear it as a dollar, but when I say the dollar is a legal tender, I know that resonates with you a lot more given your background, right? And the legal tender is exactly what validates what a sand dollar is. It's basically a digital dollar where instead of it being physically minted and then circulated in the society, this is digitally minted and circulated in society side by side by the Bahamian dollar. So it's not an investment, it's a payment tool. And what it's taking is all the pros from cryptocurrency minus the cons, meaning there's a digital asset. It brings the integrity of the central bank along with the integrity of the financial system, and is now bringing this as a complement, because when Zhivargo runs out of Bahamian digital dollars, he can then take, sorry, when he runs out of physical dollars, he has access to digital dollars. And this digital dollar is backed by the central bank. So it is good as it gets, and it's really a complement. And that's the whole thing. A lot of people think it's trying to compete. It's not cryptocurrency. That's a commodity. That's for things outside of the Bahamas. It's the sand dollar, which is the digital version of your same Bahamian dollar in your pocket. It's just that the central bank is minting it digitally versus circulating it physically. And it's showing up in your bank as a digital number. No, this starts as a digital number. And because it has that, you now have the ability to push and pull it within the network.
Yeah, and you don't have to go mine these.
No.
There's no story behind it. There's no story that pumps it up or puts it down.
Correct.
It'll fluctuate with the physical Bahamian dollar because it is a Bahamian dollar.
Correct.
So it's got the same fixed currency regime attached to it.
Correct. There's no interest being earned. The only way you earn interest is if you put it in an investment vehicle. It itself is just a vehicle. Not an investment vehicle, just a vehicle. And it's the equivalent of saying some people keep their money under the mattress. You just happen to keep your money in your phone.
And when the campaign is over, what would the central bank like the Bahamian public to be like, feel like, do when this campaign is over?
Oh, once this campaign is over, I think all of the members of the campaign is looking for a certain level of empowerment where Bahamians will have the ability to now push and pull money and manage finances in conjunction with physical cash together. So let's take this term of personal banking. Well, it becomes extremely personal if you can push and pull the digital dollars. So I think the goal of the campaign is acclimate the public, allow the public to become familiar, realize, oh, it's not this, it is actually that. And once we have that degree of familiarity, I think people will then eliminate the barriers of resistance. And the goal is that people use it side by side with their currency. So if someone now owes you some money, instead of you having to travel to send it, you say, okay, I'll just send it to you in sand dollars. And hopefully you use canoe. I got to plug canoe there. But if you know, you send it in sand dollars. And that's the wish list, that it exists side by side. It does not cannibalize cash. Cash will always have a reason. But sand dollar can do so much more than cash. And if you embrace it, you know, some of the core themes are safer, faster, greener. Digital cash just does not have the same risk as physical cash. The ability to transact is like lightning in seconds, right? And by keeping it all digital, you actually have a green effect because the storage of cash costs energy. The movement of cash costs energy. It's just, there's just a lot of people don't realize, but once you become an entrepreneur, handling cash is a business in all itself. And you can actually eliminate that by going digital and getting the benefits. So the goal is that Bahamians understand what sand dollars are, do not confuse it with cryptocurrency, understand what wallets are, use it effectively in their everyday life, and realize, oh, I am empowered with options because if I forget my physical wallet, I just use my digital wallet. And my digital wallet is no better or worse than Apple Pay, Zelle, or any of these things that people use when they leave the country. But we can now say, no, this is available in the Bahamas. And we took it one step further. We're not just doing digital wallets and digital payments. We're actually driving this by a central bank digital currency that could actually transform how commerce is done. But my personal goal and the campaign's goal is the education would be much higher, the appreciation would be much higher, and then that should lead to a greater adoption because then people will find the usefulness in it.
Mr. Callard Braithwaite, ladies and gentlemen, from the Central Bank. I told you, Central Bank don't joke around. They're sending you the most articulate, capable staff of they have ever whenever they send somebody. And so there you get it. So we're going to talk to you all again tomorrow, maybe day after, but soon about this digital campaign.
But thank you for your time, Mr. Laing. And just to be clear, I'm working with canoe in conjunction with the central bank.
Absolutely.
They brought everybody together. And that's why I got to give them kudos. They're bringing a rising tide floats all boats, and they're bringing everyone together.
Thank you very much, sir. We'll talk to yourselves on the next edition.
Thank you, sir.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad that you could join us. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm.
Mashtagar, the lady run into me, Mashtagar.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull out the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Wait, you know what's going down tomorrow?
Nobody, what happening?
Joe bringing the knife to school? He could do Junior in?
For what?
Wait, he fooled with Joe girl?
Mother sick. And you know Junior don't bark down for nothing. So that means he got a big fight tomorrow.
So whose side you on?
Side? I trying to stay in school, not Simpson fan. We gotta tell somebody about this fight.
Tell somebody? I ain't no snitch. I mean cool, you know.
Wait, if you so cool, then you need to stay in school and stay out of the fight.
Yeah, but if I don't hang on Joe's side, him and he boys coming for me next.
All right, so we definitely gotta tell somebody. We gotta prevent the fight.
What I say, I don't want nobody call me snitch.
We could just call Crime Stoppers. You could report what you know, and nobody gotta know it's you.
So how do I wait?
All you gotta do is call them, or you text them through the Crack Crime Bahamas app, and nobody can know it's you.
Then the police come looking for me for more info, and when they finish with them, Joe them coming looking for me?
When you call Crime Stoppers, the calls go directly to Miami, and they don't ask nothing about you. Then you can get the pen from them, and they can claim a reward later using that same pen.
Plus, everything's scrambled, so nobody can read what you saying.
Calls 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers to do so are 323-36232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316 or 325-4259, 325-4259. From the Family Islands, you can call us on 242-300-5720. That's 242-300-5720. You can text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. Couple of things. Let's talk about today. Couple of things. First of all, let's talk about the F&M upcoming convention. You and I live in the Bahamas, at least those of us who live here. Some of you are listening from outside of the country, but that's okay. You know this country perhaps too. And you know, on Jungle New Day, on Boxing Day, and New Year's Day, no matter who wins, and no matter how clear the victory, what do you hear? What do you hear? They cheated. They cheated. They cheated. They rob us. They rob us. That's our Jungle New experience every year, day in and day out. That's part of the conversation. We have elections in this country, general elections. What do you hear most times the general election takes place? No matter how significant the victory of one party over the other. They rob us. They rob us. Remember 1987? To this day, you cannot tell some FNMs that the PLP did not steal the 1987 election. To this day. Huh? When the FNM won the election in 92, oh, it was money. It was money. They used money. And the PLP won the election. Oh, they used the numbers man money. That's what the FNM said. Always up. Always something. Well, the FNM hasn't even gone in the convention yet. Hasn't gone in the convention yet. Has not gone in the convention. Ladies and gentlemen, I have been involved with several FNM conventions involved in elections. And I know what I see. I know what I observed. Now, the Minister side is saying, they don't like some of the things they have see going on, what the leader's doing and what Dr. Sands is doing. Like what? Like holding elections at the constituency level.
Huh?
Really? First of all, constituency association elections, I think, are held in accordance with the party's constitution, right? So does the constitution say that elections shouldn't be held in a certain period prior to convention? If the constitution says that, then it shouldn't happen. But does the constitution say that? Secondly, is this the same situation that was being accused of similar maturations around convention time? These are things you hear almost every convention, round convention. Who trying to manipulate the associations to get their delegates in? That's the first thing. The second thing I heard, and I thought this was quite profound, actually. I think Mr. Miller, according to an article in the Nassau Guardian, Mr. Burton Miller, who seems to be a principal campaigner for Mr. Minister's campaign, was arguing, listen to this argument, he was arguing that the leader, Mr. Michael Pintard and Dr. Sands, and the leadership of the FNM put on the election committee people who are supporters of Mr. Pintard and no supporter of Dr. Minnis. Now, when I listened to that, I thought that was rather strange. Why? You're the leader. You are the leader of a party. The people who you appoint to a committee are supposed, I believe, FNMs. That's the criteria for being on the committee, the convention committee. You have to be a duly certified member of the party, right? So where does this Minnis Pintard thing come in? One, because Mr. Pintard is the leader of the whole FNM. Well, remember, those who support him or don't support him don't make no difference. Him and Dr. Sands is the chairman of the whole FNM. When it's time for them to appoint people to the committee, what are they supposed to decide who is a Minnis person, who is a Pintard person, when Dr. Minnis only very recently nominated himself and announced that he would be running and contesting for leader? Before that, nobody knew that he was running. So how does the party go around then saying, oh, but we should pick that person because that person is a Minnis person? A Minnis person for what? At the time that you're selecting, there was no Minnis nominated effort for the contesting the seat in the convention. So what is... Can you explain that to me, anybody? Anybody, explain that to me. How a party is supposed to decide. We have nobody contesting the leadership. We have to appoint a convention committee. But now I'm just walking around thinking, oh, you know, they F&Ms, but that's a Pintad F&M. No, but that's a Minutes F&M. Really? And let's be practical and pragmatic here. You think Celinda is going to point to a convention committee, people who he doesn't trust? He doesn't have confidence, can do the job? Won't try to shank him? You think Mr. Ingram would have done that? Mr. Christie would have done that? You think Brad Davis would do that? I mean, I wonder sometimes, what are we thinking in this country? What? Do we think people who are sitting around listening to us talk will not consider, that don't make no sense? Well, every leader I know who has a position will seek to ensure that she is not disadvantaging herself by doing things. But of course, a credible leader will ensure that they're not doing any skullduggery, they're not violating the constitution of the party, they're not breaking any laws, they're not being, I have to say this, borderline unethical, because trust me, we don't want to talk about ethical practices and behavior when it comes to some of the activities that go on around politics of our country. We don't want to do that. Let me tell you all what happened. I mean, I'm not asking you, I'm telling you what happened. The last one I ran, a reporter provided us with information that this happened. On the night that the election returns were coming in, they were at the headquarters of a colleague of mine, a colleague. And if I'm pressed, I will call their name. Colleague of mine. And said the colleague was sitting down in his chair. So you know, as a man, watching the convention returns. And when Carl Bethel, so you know I make this up, this is what they told me, this is just how they said it to me. When Carl Bethel's return came in, and Carl had obviously lost, this is what the colleague did. This is what was described to me. The colleague leaned back in the chair, clapped his hands and rubbed it together and said, now all we need is Zhivargo to lose and we got it. A colleague of mine, and people around here, we won't talk about skullduggery and the like around election time. Let's be real, man. The F&M has run conventions for years and years and years. People around the election time, the people who are there tallying the votes, oftentimes very noted professional people in the accounting realm, in the legal profession, and all the like. It is absolute nonsense. Nonsense for people to be talking nonsense in the PLP or the F&M about these kinds of stuff. Stop it. Because your history is long. Everybody, go convince those delegates to vote for you. Get their vote, get the vote you get, and shut your mouth and take your win or take your loss, whichever it is. But don't do that, man. I just had to laugh. I literally had to laugh. Absolutely had to laugh. And listen to me, man. Let me tell you something. All the stories that can be told. All the stories that can be told about the Michael Pintad wrote a book called Politrix. You all know that? Politrix. This text says, say they rob us. Yeah, that's what they say. They cheat. So don't worry, Z. They are preparing themselves for this beating. This will be their cry. You know, oftentimes when you see people crying this way, it does indicate that there is some lack of confidence in being able to win. And sometimes you're trying to preempt a defeat. I don't know what's going to happen. Can I disclose something to you? I am a delegate to the convention. It is a thing reserved for people who have served, as I have served as an elected official for the Free National Movement. And so I am aware of, I am knowledgeable of many, many of the things happening insofar as the effort toward the convention and all the campaign. People have contacted me, reached out to me, can I get your vote? Can I do this? Can I do that? The next thing, et cetera. So I understand what's going on. You know what I mean? But this is crazy talk to me. I mean, they appointed people who are not mini supporters. What's the criteria for being on the convention committee, you think? Being a Pentad supporter? Being an Ingram supporter? Being a Cecil supporter? What's the criteria? What should be? Does this party not have a constitution? And does the constitution say that when you are selecting a convention committee, you shall ensure that supporters of each contesting party should be there? So what about the people who support Elsewhere Johnson and Wayne Sands? And what about all the other positions and their people? Absolutely incredible stuff to me. Oh boy, let me see. We have a text here. Anyways, it's not long now. It's Saturday is when the election for the party will be held. And I have no doubt that when it is done, remember now, well, everybody so far who's running for the leadership, Mr. Pintar, Dr. Minnis, have all said, when it's all said and done, we will support the party wholeheartedly. All have said that. But you know what is all the caveat used in politics for that? I didn't think they would be cheating, though. So that's what happens. From the tune, folks then tell me. But I can tell you all one thing. Let me tell you all something I know about politics. Can I tell you all this? And don't tell nobody I told you this. Don't nobody tell you I tell you. I don't care how opposed someone you see people are. You let the people who are opposed to that person leave in the next election. You watch them come around. Political parties and political people are pragmatic that way. They don't want to be left out. Or, you know, you ever hear that word? FOMO? FOMO? Fear of missing out. Yeah. So a lot of times when you see people challenging someone within the party, that's because they are doubtful about the person's ability to win. They get whim. Oh, this win coming. Watch and see the tone. Nobody's seen it 1,000 times. Over and repeated. You or she would be shocked sometimes. The difference in tone. Shocked. People, but doesn't that you who was utterly and adamantly opposed to that person before? This text is good afternoon. So now the Benjamin Trump is crying, stolen election, voter fraud, and start to steal. Say when Starbucks receives sand, we'll use it. You only can use the sand dollar if you could get coffee. That's not right. Mr. X says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. Remember, evil thinks as evil does. We humans just expect others to behave like we do. It's called projection. That is true. And also, it's, you know, I often say to people that you are thinking about me that way, but you are describing me from your own autobiography. Let me say it again. You are thinking about me that way because you are describing me from your own autobiography. That's as this text has said. Because you know that's what you would do. You expect that that's what I would do. I just don't understand it. I mean, like, at the end of the day, if you get out there and say, oh, the FNM leadership doing skullduggery, oh, they doing trickery, oh, they doing this and the next thing, and then you have a convention, and then after your convention, you go into the Bahamian public, and you're going to say to the Bahamian public, vote FNM, vote for our leader. Because, why? Why? I don't know. I know one thing. If I was PLP, I'd be laughing straight through. Yeah. Carry on. Carry on. Yeah, they cheating. Yeah, they cheating. Because that just looks good. It just helps with their cause. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We can take a little break for our sponsors and then go into the news break. We'll be back after the news break. I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
And there are no... Are you a business owner or HR professional? RF's team of pension specialists are here to empower your employees with market-leading retirement solutions and to make implementing group pensions easy and cost-effective. With RF, starting or switching your company pension plan is a breeze, and there are no setup fees. If you're looking for strong investment performance and low fees, visit rfgroup.com/empower and empower your team to retire comfortably with RF Group Pensions today. That's rfgroup.com/empower.
Hello, my FNM family. My name is Rona Paul, and I currently serve as a youth representative for the FNM Central and South Abaco Association. It is with immense joy and pleasure that I endorse Mr. Michael C. Pintard as he seeks to be re-elected as our party's leader. Mr. Pintard epitomizes the words of John C. Maxwell. A leader is one who knows the way, goes the way, and shows the way. Throughout Mr. Pintard's stellar leadership, he has proven to be a man that places service above self. He is a man who dares to stand tall in the face of challenges, and his resiliency must be commended. He embodies all the necessary elements needed for excellent leadership. Moreover, he is the right man for the job.
Yes, yes, I work it with Pintard, cause he work it with me. Boy, only work it with Pintard, cause he work it with me.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Looking for a breakfast that will wake up your taste buds and kickstart your day? Well, Burger King Nassau has got you covered with the new Angry Crust Sandwich. Made with fluffy eggs, melted cheese, jalapenos, a spicy sauce, and your choice of ham, sausage, or bacon on a warm croissant. Make it a combo and add our signature hash browns and your choice of coffee, tea, or orange juice for a great way to start your day. Spice up your breakfast with the new Angry Crust Sandwich combo only at Burger King Nassau.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
325-4316 or 325-4259. You can call us from the Family Islands on 242-300-5720. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. You know, Michael Pintard was chairman of the Free National Movement when Dr. Minnis became its leader. Eventually, he resigned his post as chairman. But does anybody remember that notwithstanding his significant role in the Minnis FNM administration, not the government, the party, Michael Pintard got a nomination for the party very, very late. It was delayed. Everybody was getting named. This one was getting named. That one was getting named. And Michael was not being nominated. Michael Pintard actually ran in the Marco City seat, and I was the first person who publicly endorsed him for that seat. Right? This is way back in the first. But it was delay after delay, and part of my endorsement of him was this delay, this substantial amount of delay that had been taking place, because I knew that he could be a good candidate for the Marco City seat. That delay was a function of the relationship that he had with Dr. Minnis. And so I'm saying Dr. Minnis was the leader of the party and deciding on the fate of people as he saw fit. And now you have some of his people who are saying Mr. Pintard, as leader, is doing things that they are concerned about. Really? The Honorable Michael Halkidis, the minister responsible for economic affairs in the country, said that Bahamians have good reason to be hopeful in the upcoming budget. The Bahamians have good reason to be hopeful. And in speaking to the reasons to be hopeful, he was talking about the positive trends that the government finances are experiencing over the last 2.5 years of the Davis administration. He mentioned the fact that the fiscal deficit has been declining. That is true. He mentioned the fact that there has been a strong recovery following the pandemic, and that is true. But he also noted, as I have indicated to yourselves many times, that just following the strong recovery, that things are going to return to more normal growth, and that they are pleased with the 2.5% projected growth that they have. And so he says, on the basis of these things, and he wasn't preempting the budget, but there's some things that are going to be forecasted going forward that he thinks will please Bahamians. So now that is what the government minister said. He also mentioned, and I thought rightly so, that Dr. Mala Dukaran, who's an economist, a noted economist in the region, had been predicting for quite some time now that the Bahamas was going to default on its debt and at the end, and will have to enter an IMF program. And that it's never happened. Did anybody go back and ask Ms. Dukaran what happened? No one did. I challenged it myself. I didn't understand where she was coming from with all of that. But, you know, it made lots of news, lots of front page stories. And as he indicated, no such thing has happened. But the government minister is saying that you, Bahamians, have good Pause for Hope. Remember, the budget is going to be presented to Parliament, ought to be on Wednesday. We are here. What is or is not the good news? But what would give you hope for the upcoming budget? I know what the minister said, but I'm asking you, what would give you hope? Why would you be hopeful as you wait for the 2024-2025 fiscal budget? What would give you hope? This text says, yes, they were dissing Mike for a nomination. People have short memories. Yeah. Says, great show as usual. Every time I see my salary for the Christmas, I say they were. This text is, so after these elections at the FNM convention results on Saturday, I believe Dr. Minister will receive less than 20% of the votes to return as leader, after which I hope he finally gets the message, goes and sits down, retire from politics, and allow another young person in the party to run in a traditionally FNM seat of Kalani, which Mr. Ingram afforded to him to run in 2007. That's a big ask. It's a big, big ask. But, you know, you'll see. What would give you hope? Hope. You know what hope is? Anybody knows what hope is? Best definition of hope I have is that it is the positive expectation. It is the expectation that something positive will happen for you in the future. It is the expectation that something positive will happen for you in the future. Another great definition of hope I was told was that hope is knowing where you're going, having a plan to get there, and actually executing the plan. That's hope. You know where you're going, you have a plan to get there, and you are actually executing the plan. Why would you, and do you have hope, as the minister says you ought, going into the presentation of the 2023-2024 fiscal budget? It's Texas, no leader is perfect, but I am not hearing any grand vision. What do we want the Bahamas to look like in the next 20 years? Should we form a federation, for example, with other like-minded small countries, example, TCI or larger English-speaking Caribbean? Yeah, that's a profound ask, for sure. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. I'm doing well.
Hey, I'm good. I'm good. Yourself?
Yeah. I just want to make a quick comment. Not only was Mr. Pentad's nomination delayed, Mr. Laing, out of the 39 candidates, he was the last one to be ratified.
I think so. He was the last, right?
Yes, the very last. And not only that, based on what was communicated to residents of Grand Bahama, they said the president could arrive in any one of the consistency in Grand Bahama and won. That's how effective and popular he was in Grand Bahama, but yet he was appointed last. You know, I remembered when I was in Dawson leading up to 2017 election, I got preempted. I was landing a blow for him, and I got preempted. And the very next season was huge. He made a comment that, you know, I did a good job in representing. But my point that I'm trying to make is, the Bible spoke, and I attributed his story, or Mr. Pentad's story, you know, biblical story. I just basically throwing this out. You know, the Bible said that first would be last, and last would be first.
And it's true. That is true.
On come Friday, we'll see exactly how that basically will turn out. But he has a good chance to become first again amongst equals in his party and opposition, mostly in the job as the incoming prime minister.
Yep, definitely. That's all well said. Thank you very much for sharing that. All right. I was trying to filter you all to Mr. Harkiris' comments about the budget coming up Ravi. But if you want to continue to talk about the FNM convention, please don't let me disturb you. I believe people will start going up to a convention as early as tomorrow, Wednesday for sure. I think there's normally a 3-day kind of period people have because you're going to do some parlaying and campaigning, and, you know, moving up and around and so forth and so forth. So people should be making their way to Nassau fairly soon to do so. And all these candidates, all of them, stressed out. Politics is stressful. You know, so I expect that lots of them are stressful. You know, we talk about Mr. Pintard and we talk about Dr. Minnis, but Dr. Sands and Elsway Johnson are also contesting for the chairmanship of the party, a very important position for the party. You know, obviously, any leader wants a chairman with whom they can work well. The chairman tries to connect and keep the leader connected to the organs of the party and to the pulse of the party. And, you know, while ensuring that the party's mechanisms and the like are ready for election, that the constituency associations are strong and doing what they have to do in accordance with the constitutional provisions of the party. And the chairman oftentimes is a spokesman for the party, not the government, but for the party, trying to ensure that its membership are aware of things that are going on and what it's, even if it's in government, what its governing party is doing. And so you often need in that position an articulate person. You need somebody who is grounded. You need somebody who shows good judgment, somebody who can relate and connect people on a very personal level, somebody who is a good conflict resolver, because you oftentimes have challenges within associations, among members, and so you have to be able to navigate those terrains. You have to have somebody who can balance between their personal life and their private and professional life and the life they have to lead in trying to be the chairman of the party. You have to have somebody who can support the leader of the party in trying to execute the vision of the party and the plans of the party. You have to have somebody who can help support the effort of fundraising and that kind of stuff. So the leader, the chairman can be is a very dynamic person, mind you, in their own right, could be somebody regarded for leadership, or it may in fact be regarded for leadership in the future. They get to know the organs of the party very well. They get to know the constituencies and their associations, the leaders in those constituencies, etc. So they have a great deal of opportunity to become familiar with them and for their people to become familiar with them. And so forth. It's quite demanding because in an archipelago such as ours, you not only have to make your way through all the constituency associations on New Providence, but you got to go to the family islands and show up and be able to deal with all the matters that arise in the course. You don't only have the constituency associations, you have the women's association, you have the youth association. And so you have to contend with all of those things when you are the chairman of the party. And so Dr. Dwayne Sands is contesting against Mr. Elsway Johnson, both quite capable gentlemen. As Mr. Pintard said when he was on the show, he said, you know, our bench is deep. That's how he said it. And the fact that you have, you know, two quality people who are competing that way, you know, that is something. And you see Mr. Dr. Sands ain't taking it lightly because, you know, he's putting his ads and stuff out there because he wants to get the support of the delegates to the convention. And, of course, I don't think anybody contested for the deputy leadership, eh? I don't think so. I think it's Sharon Dorn, Cartwright going in unopposed. I don't recall hearing any other positions being contested. That position being contested. I know that other positions like trustees and them and vice chair and them, they may all have people vying for those. Ms. Tech says, good day, good show. With regard to Hubert Minnis and the FNM leadership race, I think he made poor decisions during the period after Dorian, as well as managing COVID. I will give one example. During COVID, he decided to pour sidewalks for Capital Works and didn't think to complete the government office and school on Grand Bahama, which was 80% and 90% completed. By the way, that was a low-hanging fruit that he would have been able to point to. Instead, the brave administration will benefit by saying they completed that project. Those type decisions ultimately make persons like somebody less confident, or like myself, less confident in his leadership ability. I would like to see Pintard as leader, says that text. This text says the chairman has quite a critical role elsewhere. This is question mark this person has. Shannon Dawn is unopposed. Well, there you go. There you go. Well, y'all are obviously more interested in the FNM convention than y'all are in the budget coming up. What would make Bain is interested in budget coming up? If you thought that would be an announcement that each of you would be given a sum of money in the upcoming budget, how about if civil servants were heard that they would get a raise? What would give you enthusiasm about a budget? Tax cuts. Matt is going to be checked by 5 percentage points. Would that do it? All VAT on bread basket items, insurance, and the like will be removed. Would that do it? What custom duty cuts would you be fascinated to see? What would get you excited? They say budget? Yeah, after Saturday. All right, I'm not gonna fight that battle. It's the convention. It's the convention. I have to say, it is rather remarkable that there is considerable interest in the convention by lots of people. And it is, to me, more remarkable that a lot of it does have to do with the fact that Dr. Minnis entered the race. I think that he has given a lot of people interest in this race. He is indicating, Michael Pintard had a endorsement of event on Friday, and he was endorsed by pretty much most of the cabinet ministers from the Minnis administration, and many from the Ingram administration, very high endorsements. So Dr. Minnis, though, has said that he is unbothered by that. He said, that's the beauty of democracy. You could be with me today, and someone else tomorrow. That don't affect me. I stay focused. And when I saw those remarks from Dr. Minnis, I said, that is interesting. Because Mr. Ingram knows that statement that Dr. Minnis made. Remember? Dr. Minnis, as I know it and understand it, is and was a very close friend of Hubert Ingram. In fact, Ingram said it. Remember they did the book presentation? Ingram said that him and Dr. Minnis were close, and then when he became prime minister, say he go on a separate way. So, Mr. Ingram knows of what Dr. Minnis said. You could be with me today and someone else tomorrow. Because remember when he went to by election, he became leader of the Free National Movement. Dr. Minnis said, why? The Ingram era is over. Like, why was it necessary to make that pronouncement? And it broke a lot of people's heart who were supporters of Mr. Ingram. They thought it was callous. They thought it was insensitive. So he said, but that don't affect me. I stay focused. Midday or something. I can't say what's in anybody's heart. But I can assure you, ain't nobody want to see people not support them openly. Nobody. He says, I know where I want to go. I know what I want to do. I know what I want to do for the young people. I know what I want to do for the population. I know what I want to do for the country. And I keep that in mind. That's my focus. The others are just deterrents. Actually, a strong statement, you know, good statement too. I know people say, oh, well, this I. We have no difficulty with that. I have no difficulty with that because you are competing for leadership. You when your name is on the ballot, your name is in there with Charlie and Charlene and this one. Your name is there as Dr. Hubert Minnis, Mr. Michael Pintard. So you are talking about your vision. Yeah, you're talking about your interests, your desires. Now, you know that you have to work with people for that, but so it's not a problem to be able to say, I know what I want to do. That's a great statement. Because you want a leader who knows what they want to do, where they're going, and so forth, and so forth, and so forth. They just now have to make sure where they want to go and what they're doing. Other people want to go there with them and doing it with them. That's where the lead. That's where the real leadership shows up, you know. Can I tell you that again? Real leadership requires you to have a vision of things. But it is incomplete if you can't bring others with you, because the only reason leadership is necessary is because the thing you are seeking to accomplish cannot be accomplished by yourself. If you could do it by yourself, you don't need to run for nothing. You don't need to hop for nothing. You just go and do it because you could do it by yourself. But because you have to do it with other people and you have to get them to put their collective energies, minds together and move in the same direction and to be coordinated in the process and cooperative in the process and collaborative in the process, you need to be able to lead them. That's the reason for leadership. So personal vision, ambition, talent, skills, all necessary, but incomplete. Without the ability to influence other people to do what is necessary and what can be done to cause a people or a group to achieve a certain end. That's leadership. The ability to influence others. And in a democracy, you have to be able to influence enough others just to get the position to be able to do the things you want to do. All right? So I always tell people in my leadership seminars that leadership is a duet. It is a dance between the leader and the people he or she is leading. And so if you are only mindful of yourself in that dance, something gonna buck up. It ain't gonna work. Bible says, how can two walk together except they be agreed? And that's the job of leadership. Bring the level of agreement necessary to make a collective effort at achieving our common goal. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break. We'll be right back.
business owner or HR professional? RF's team of pension specialists are here to empower your employees with market-leading retirement solutions and to make implementing group pensions easy and cost-effective. With RF, starting or switching your company pension plan is a breeze, and there are no setup fees. If you're looking for strong investment performance and low fees, visit rfgroup.com/empower and empower your team to retire comfortably with RF Group pensions today. That's rfgroup.com/empower.
The Grand Bahama News is available every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian. You can buy your local paper at Freeport convenience stores, Western Bakery, DeGregory's Fine Foods, and Bellevue Gifts. Now is the time to reach your Grand Bahama market with affordable packages, including print and digital. Call GB News sales representative Kavandre at 822-6717 or message him on WhatsApp for ad rates. Classified ads are now available every Tuesday as well. Keep up with everything Grand Bahamian every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian.
Good evening. My name is Roscoe Thompson III. I am the chairman of the F&M branch here in Central South Abaco, and I fully endorse Michael C. Bentard as our next leader of this great party, the F&M. He has shown his leadership in the House of Assembly, holding this administration accountable to the Bahamian people, and he has done an excellent job in representing the House as opposition leader. I fully support Michael C. Bentard and his leadership because we need a new direction and we need new leadership in this party. And as I said earlier, come June 1st, Michael C. Bentard will be the next leader of the F&M and our soon-to-be Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
Yes, yes, I work in the penitocracy, working with me. Boy, only work in the penitocracy, working with me. Man, I work in the penitocracy, working with me.
So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. Can I, let me tell y'all something. And listen, how you spin what I'm going to say is up to you. But that's, then that's in politics sometimes, like you draw some very convenient cards, or you could draw some very inconvenient cards. So let me give you an example. In 1992, when the Mr. Ingram was seeking to win the government, when he was seeking to retain government, he sought to introduce some young faces and talent in the party. Michael Bentard was one such person. Daphne Cooper was another one, and myself was another one. Ingram first sought to get me to run in the High Rock seat, which was a fairly good seat for an F&M candidate, which had been, this is the seat that had been held by Maurice Moore for quite a while. And so it was a seat that an F&M would comfortably win, right? That did not happen. I ended up running in Fort Charlotte, which had been won by the Free National Movement Corps, and so therefore was a winnable seat by the Free National Movement. Daphne Cooper ran, I believe, I don't remember now where she ran, but she was also in a, it was a tough seat, but, you know, possibly winnable given the popularity of Ingram at the time. Michael Bentard drew Centerville against Perry Christie and the PLP. Mr. Christie had won that seat for decades. Michael ran in that seat. Honestly, and went after it with enthusiasm. That's how he did, does it, right? When he ran again for the party, man was put up against Brad Davis in Cat Island. And he drew a close draw, but again, a very tough situation. Right?
Me?
I drew Marco City. Again, winnable, but still tough because Spurs and Bridgewater was a fairly popular thing, but it was winnable. I mean, of course, Cat Island, you could say it was winnable, but you know, that was a hard draw for Michael Pinter. And that has been his history. The draw, hard draws. Dr. Minnis was given Polani, which had been won, whether it was Delaporte or whatever, had been won by the F&M for time immemorial. It was regarded as an F&M safe seat. And Michael Pintard has demonstrated by virtue of these contests that he has had to endure a level of stickability, termination, and just doggedness. I mean, I'm telling you this. So when somebody said the last shall be first and the first shall be last, this could be that story for sure. When I won in 1997, I became the Minister of State in the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture. Michael Pintard was appointed a consultant in that ministry to work with me. So I was his minister. Right? But he has demonstrated the ability to pay heavy dues. Heavy dues in politics. I hear people playing some game, but he's ain't no diehard F&M and all that kind of stuff. Man, listen, you could talk all the talk you want on planet Earth, but let's just look at your walk. If you'd asked 75% of F&M to run against Perry Christie in 1997, 75% of them would tell you, man, please, you got to be out your mind. Run against Brad Davis in Cat Island, 60-something% telling you got to be out your mind. Not Michael Pintard. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Hi, good afternoon.
Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, Mr. Laing.
Yes, hi. Hey, hi.
Can you hear me? Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, I'd just like to make two quick points, please. And I know you were talking about the budget, but the reality is the highlight of the week is the F&M convention.
I agree with you 100%. You ain't seen me give up the ghost? I give up the ghost.
As it relates to the F&M on the convention, I know that a lot of persons are saying that because of the hurricane, and because of COVID, the most things work against the former prime minister in that of Dr. Hubert Minnis. I tend to disagree. While he was at the helm of the ship during two catastrophes, I think more so his attitude and his arrogance is what played against him most of all. Hubert Minnis, in my opinion, too quickly, too soon. I mean, his attitude changed dramatically. And while he was preaching transparency and accountability, he himself was not a product of what he preached, because I could recall several different instances in which he address the media in an insulting fashion, in a demeaning manner. He spoke down to them, and he was pretty much insulting. There's a point where walking through and from, I remember vividly, he was walking from a conference at Bahamar, and he was surrounded by a lot of police officers. And those police officers, as the member of the press tried to engage him, they pretty much backed the members of the press off and say no questions. He didn't intervene. He didn't say, I know you're looking for some information, I'll get back to you, whatever. He kept his head down and kept moving. And time again, those are the things that he did. So while you're preaching transparency and accountability, you're not engaging the members of the public that put you in the position to which you are. So that in itself, in my opinion, worked against him. So even when Hurricane Dorian came and COVID came, people was already pissed off and fed up with him and his attitude. And the manner in which he addressed those things, yes, it was a new experience for a lot of people, but even the senior statesmen, like a Perry Christie, like a Hubert Ingraham, who offered themselves to assist, his attitude towards them showed that, listen, you want to operate as a one-man band. Hence, the reasoning behind the crushing defeat at the polls. People were adamant in trying to get rid of Hubert Minnis. Successive governments have come and gone based on leadership. People aren't necessarily against the members of parliament. They're against the leader and his style. That's what happened to Hubert Ingraham initially, then Perry Christie, now Hubert Minnis. And now all of a sudden, with his crocodile tears, he has changed and seen the light. A proof in him changing and seeing the light would have been supporting Michael Pintard, not pushing and opposing him at every turn. If he had done those things and humbled himself, I think he would be in a better position. But as it is now, I think the best thing for him to do is to sit on the side, because I don't know, there's a small handful of F&M supporters who is telling him to run. But the country, the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, they don't want Hubert Minnis. So the handful of loyalists will be better served to tell him, the people don't want you, sir. Sit on the side. Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you. Very, very clearly, said, you know, gaining power is a great privilege. Great privilege. And can imbue a person with immense sense of authority. And it takes something to really not let that get to your head. That it really does. It really does. I will never forget the advice I was given. Hey boy, don't drive in the backseat of that car. Keep your window down when you're driving. Don't walk up to an Obama's air counter thinking you could just walk past people on any line. So forth and so forth. Stay where you live. Live right there. Live right there. Right there. Ah, boy, because ain't nothing forever. If tech says, said, Ingraham is quiet, I'm concerned. Don't be concerned with that. Don't be concerned with that. Don't be concerned with that. Said, don't be, former leaders in party conventions do not make it a business coming out in the public doing their work. That's not a public work. It's a party convention. So don't be concerned about no quiet from no leader. That's not how they operate when it comes to political conventions. It would be inappropriate and odd to them do it that way. Now, that doesn't mean they can't. Well, I can't say inappropriate, but it is not usual to do it that way. That's not usual. So I'm not concerned about that at all. Says Ingraham said the minister was a different man. So I believe the minister's abrasiveness was his way of camouflaging his overall political incompetence. He may have been a good psychologist, but this does not a good leader or prime minister make. Okay. We have another call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Please, go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Hey, yes, we don't have a caller. This text says, I still mad with Dr. Minnis for saying that Ingraham era was over. See? Say to it, you know. We ladies and gentlemen, listening to Lisi Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take our final break, and when we come back, we'll continue and finish up our discussion. We'll be back.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone. I'll up if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Living with a neurological condition shouldn't define you. At Cleveland Clinic in Florida, we do whatever it takes to make life better today while discovering new treatments for a brighter tomorrow. From epilepsy management to specialized spine care and brain tumor surgery, we're delivering world-class neurology care for the day-to-day, for the days you live for every care in the world. Visit clevelandclinicflorida.org/Caribbean.
For fast, reliable, and impactful printing services, look no further. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life. We stand by our quality products that are second to none. Our affordable pricing and friendly, efficient staff makes Printmasters the ultimate choice for all your printing needs. We can deliver any type of printing services, from banners to booklets to business cards. You name it, we can print it.
Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located in Nassau Garden Building, telephone 302-23.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone. I'll up if you feel like you've been down the same road.
So glad if you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. His text says, oh, I get it. Dr. Minnis was a gynecologist. I thought he was a proctologist because for 5 years he was in. Oh, man. Boy, you all something else in the Bahamas. We got some text here. Say, with the trade war between the Western powers and the China, it may be time to have direct trade with China to avoid some of these issues. Okay. The text says, good day, a detailed plan for the next 2.5 years as to how the government intends to reduce the national debt and curtail government expenditure. That's what would make me excited about the budget. That's something. Somebody else said that slashing duty on cars by 65%. Oh my word, if that happened. If that would happen, you ought to be sitting now waiting for the budget announcement. Not the car dealers in Freeport in the Bahamas. So maybe they wouldn't mind because their car prices go down for them too. So good afternoon, Mr. Lang. If you can answer or not, I understand, but who do you support? Who do I support? This next text says, hi, Mr. Lang. The only thing I want to hear in the budget on Wednesday is how much the senior citizens' NIB increase will become in July. How much? Well, you mean increase as in payment? Yeah, okay. You think that's going to happen? Okay. So good afternoon, Mr. Lang. I think that I heard that Travis Robinson is running for deputy chair. That's right. That's right. He was on Howard's show and did mention that. And I actually was quite impressed with Travis too, listening to him. He was always, I thought, quite a mature sounding young man, but he seems to have even matured more. And I thought he was impressed. You know, I suspect that. But had Travis had a different mentor, I think he would have been in a very good position to excel in the Free National Movement. I really do. Says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. You know, Bahamians love politics. They prefer that to the hope in the budget. I don't think persons need to bash others the way they do. You can critique without being mean. At the end of the day, we are all humans and have feelings. Blessings. Yeah. That might be true, but unfortunately, sometimes the people you back in are the ones who act that way, and so people feel justified in doing it. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. You just know it happens. It's Texas. Mr. Laing, the caller is correct about Dr. Minnis. His attitude was terrible, and his treatment of Bahamian people was unbecoming. And look what he said. Next time for the poor people. He revealed his colors already. The country don't need Dr. Minnis. It's Texas. Let's not forget Robert. Dr. Minnis, Dr. Hubert Minnis, locked the country down without notice, having people in a panic without medicine and without water, arresting the coconut boy and the man getting water for his sick father at the government pump. That draconian style of leadership Bahamians do not want. It's Texas. Minnis had three catastrophes on his watch, Ragged Island, Dorian, and the pandemic, yet he still managed to solve the dump problem and secured the DBIA and ALU. Fire says that pick. So don't forget the snap election. The upcoming convention is important. The outcome is not known to anyone, so there's no certainty of the outcome, even though there are lots of people who have views about what is likely to happen. And until it actually happens, anything is possible. Anything is possible. You could wake up on June 2nd and Michael Pintard would be leader, or you could wake up on June 2nd and Hubert Minnis could be leader. That is all possible. I didn't say how probable it is. I didn't say it's all possible because we don't know the outcome yet. We don't know. But it's important because it sets the stage for the competition that will come in the next election. You know, I have to say, I hear some people, as they comment on these things, talking about, what is your vision, or what is your this, and what is your that. And sometimes, imposing on people, like, why don't you forgive this one, or why can't somebody be forgiven, and all that kind of stuff. Listen to me. Voters vote how they want. Vote how they want. And if they don't want to forgive you, they don't have to forgive you. If they want to forgive you, they forgive you. And they can forgive you and still not take you back. How many men, women forgive them and don't come back? How many women have men forgive them and don't come back? You can forgive somebody and say, I don't hold nothing against you, bro. But you ain't gonna be in this relationship with me no more, right? So this is a national affair. This is politics. There's no friendship with you and your buddy. This is not your hubby and you. This is a secular process for determining the potential leader of the government of the Bahamas. And what should reign is rationality. Are you a fit person to lead us? Does your record demonstrate that you are a fit person to lead us? Does your articulation now, does your expressions now, does your rationalizations now, does your logic now tell me you are a fit person to lead us? Do you have the kind of skills capable of bringing people together and influencing them to do the right kinds of things? That's what matters. And if I don't want to take all them things into consideration and I just like you, it's okay too. I like you. I can vote for you. It's your vote. But all this highfalutin talk, if highfalutin requirements are what you need for selecting your leader, that's on you. If somebody just said, you know, that's a doggone good-looking man, I can vote for him. She's a good-looking woman, I can vote for her. Well, no one ain't good-looking, but I can vote for them. They're right. And that's how it's going to work. And when people get in the polls, you ain't know what's in their hair. They can be sitting there going, yeah, the last time I see you, look, they give me this look that I did not appreciate. Bam, I will not be voting for you. I can vote for this one against you. Yes. You ain't know. Let's be real, man. Let's be real. People have many things that they contemplate, consider when they go and vote for a person. Many things. Just when in politics, you don't even know sometimes when you offend people. You just thinking you about living your life. And you just pondering all that you have to do tomorrow, and you walk past somebody and didn't say hello, and for the rest of their life and their children's life and their children's children's life, they are against you. It happens. Some people are petty and small that way. You can't do nothing to them, that's their vote. They could do with their vote as they wish. This text says, Ingram was direct, but performed well for all generally. I supported the PLP, Mr. Minnis. Dr. Minnis was rude to me, and I will not forgive him, says this texter. This text says, I want to wake up with June 2nd. Brave Davis is the leader. This text says, once bitten, like Jai. And if that's your thing, and that's what how you can do it, so be it. We can be talking about this some more. As things evolved, everywhere you go, everywhere I go, people talking about it, eh? People laughing. What you think happened, man? What you think should happen? Y'all don't ask me why I'm supporting, man, because I can't get in it like that. I'm a human being, I have a vote, I have preferences, and I totally will exercise it, but don't ask me. And in the circumstances in which I find myself, it is not appropriate for me to do so. All right? So this text said, Pinta, I don't know. You've been listening to Z-Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. God spares our lives. We will be back with you tomorrow. Y'all take care and have a great, great evening. Everybody.